Renos Papadopoulos. We will have a few very interesting announcements about developments of basically home pages, research-related home pages all over Europe. We will do this after Renos Papadopoulos' speech. So you're welcome to stay here for 15 minutes longer. And therefore, Speaker's Corner will also start 15 minutes later. And any other decentral events, like the city tour and others in small groups, will also start 15 minutes later. So please stay with us, if you like, for 15 minutes more. Now, I'm very happy to announce our keynote speaker of tonight. Professor Renos Papadopoulos is a director of the Center for Trauma, Asylum and Refugees at the University of Essex in Great Britain. He's a truly multinational person, born and raised in Cyprus, having studied psychology in former Yugoslavia when it still existed, having made his PhD in Cape Town, in South Africa, as much as I understand, even still in the times when apartheid was still existing there, and now for quite a number of years, a professor in Great Britain. The other interesting thing about him, he combines the training of a Jungian analyst with the training of a systemic family therapist. The other special thing about him, that he has been consulting for United Nations and non-governmental institutions in refugee work in different countries of the world, as much as I know at least in Sudan, I think in Sierra Leone, and in a number of other countries. So, and he will give us a speech on the question of what research can do in supporting refugees. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yes. Right. Thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you very much also for the invitation to come to this remarkable conference, which is most impressive. It's interesting that the theme of refugees has received sufficient attention in different events here. And today, now, I would like to share some of my own thoughts and ideas and mainly dilemmas about working in this field. And it's going to be both about, crudely speaking, theory as well as practice. So let us start. In this presentation, in effect, what I will be doing will be what is referred to as prolegomena. And those of you who had a classical education or philosophical education, you will know that prolegomena simply means those things that you say before the logos. In other words, before you speak about something, what are the basic assumptions behind that? And it's interesting that usually it is translated as introduction or prologue, but, well, we're in Germany, so Immanuel Kant wrote his Critique of Pure Reason, and after that he wrote the prolegomena, which means that the idea of prolegomena is not just simply an introduction to something, but is when you go back and you realize what lies behind that. And this is, in effect, all my work is prolegomena to the ideas of refugees. I keep going back and trying to understand what is behind the ideas that we have about refugees and how we work with refugees. So it's another way of putting it with systemic context, keep on thinking about the epistemological presuppositions underlying our ideas. So then when we're talking is what, who, and where are these phenomena? When we're talking about refugees, what are the relevant phenomena? And is it what or is it who? or is it where? And essentially, the question is, what are our epistemological premises that position us? I like the word position, positioning, position, to position as a verb, how it positions us, not just as a noun, our position is that. What makes us to adopt that position? What are the epistemological premises that position us in a certain way, that we see certain phenomena in the way we do? And this is not just an abstraction. For example, when we look at this, what do we see? This is my own photograph from Chios. What do we see? Do we see a wonderful European beaches being spoiled by these others that are coming to take away our jobs and this and that? Is that what we see? Or do we see people who are coming to somehow help us to reconnect with our humanity that we might have been losing with all our materialistic preoccupations and things like that? I like to call these more poetically, these for me are the orange stigmata in our European consciousness. And the question is this is not just rhetorical, playing with words. Perhaps the best way to grasp these things is with poetical language and not with logical and sequential conceptual ideas. So, going back to the slide, what are then the implications of this positioning? And how can we increase the accuracy of our epistemological sensitivity? And ultimately, what are the limits of our endeavors? In other words, do we see that we're there to save them and save the world and change the world and all of that? Or how do we see the limits of what we can do? Because any kind of intervention should have some kind of idea of our limitations. We're asking our students at the end of every dissertation to say the limitations of this study. So the key terms, which in effect is also the key phenomena in this field for me, well, the title was given to me by the organizers who kindly invited me here, so I took it, and let's try to look at all three key terms, the refugees, aid, and systemic research. So if we're looking about refugees, on whom are we focusing? Where is our focus? Who are the refugees, or working with refugees, where do we focus? Do we focus on these people who are moving? Do we focus on the communities that they left behind? We don't think about that. There are very few studies about, actually, I know of only one. You will get used to my Mediterranean exaggeration. I know of only one study. But what is happening to the communities that they left? So what is happening? These people have not come from Mars. They belong to certain societies. And on their way to recreate another society, reconnect with another society, they're also not meteoric. They are interacting with other societies. So, where are we putting our focus? On the refugees, on their interactions with the places that they left, with the interactions with the places where they are now, or whether they are going to go? And when they were talking and interacting with us, who is the us? Us as what? As simply Europeans? But with what differences and with what characteristics? And if we're talking about us as helpers, are all helpers the same? Not just simply different theoretical contexts, but also different organizations that we belong to, different projects that we are asked to intervene. So we need to keep an eye on all of these things, especially, and this is the thing that I will be emphasizing all the time, because we have the potentiality, being systemic thinkers, not just simply mental health practitioners. And we know the distinction between those two, and that is another thing that I will be emphasizing. So we are beyond the idea of just simply looking at the health, but also we're looking at the systemic interactions. And then, of course, there is the big question as to whether, or, you know, the big debate, refugees and migrants, etc. I happen to feel rather strongly with a lot of colleagues that actually that debate, from our perspective, not from the politicians, is actually an inappropriate debate. Because as far as we are concerned, these people left their country because the living conditions were inappropriate in terms of viability, in terms of human dignity, etc. So we're not talking just about the legal definition of refugees. So, and then again, if we're talking about refugees, when does a refugee stop being a refugee? You know, people feel that they're refugees 80 years later. But what do they mean by that? They mean that that experience still affects them, but are they then refugees? So there is a lot of differentiation and finer distinction that is required of us to make when we're thinking about who are the refugees. And again, the key thing for me, well, all of them are, is the legal, political, human rights, or psychological perspectives. We understand what the legal are. It's a very clear legal definition of who is a refugee. The overwhelming majority of people that we're working with possibly do not fit into that. That means we're not working with refugees. So who are refugees? We need to be troubled by these questions, and it's not just simply things that are given. We need to question them. So, you know, the refugee crisis, as we call it, as we know, has been part of the political football that has been played in these countries, in our countries recently. So there are the political dimensions there. There are the human rights dimensions. All of them are important. But how do we discern? How do we differentiate these different discourses when we are getting involved to do anything with whatever group of people we defined as refugees? So these questions are important. And again, going back to the way that these are presented to us, what is it that we see here? Are we seeing survivors and resilient people, or are we seeing victims? Are we seeing people who are potentially coming to help us, or are we seeing people who are coming to create trouble for us? And when, these are not my photographs, I don't photograph people with faces. These are human beings. Journalists do that in order to sort of evoke things for us. And this is the question, you know, what is there? What are their epistemological premises, explicit or implicit, behind presenting as somebody smiling or somebody struggling? And just earlier I was talking about the feminization of the refugee identity, that whereas before we're thinking of refugees as the strong men who are involved in political change in their countries, and as a consequence they become refugees, whereas now the predominant image of refugees are the poor, helpless women who are screaming, who lost everybody, etc., and they are there for us to pity them, so that we can put our hands in our pockets, or we can petition our members of parliament to give them asylum. So we need to think about what are these contexts, and what are these perspectives that we're approaching a situation. So inevitably we're thinking of these wider discourses, the dominant narratives, as we call them, whatever other words we can use in considering these. And central to that It seems to me there is the othering process. They are not us, they are them. There's something other. And when we're talking about other, we're in Heidelberg. And this is where Hegel wrote a lot about the other. And it's important that we are, yes, modern thinkers, and it's important to look at our modern things that are happening in neuroscience, etc., but we should also be enriched by the wisdom of the past. And thinking about Hegel, here in Heidelberg, he got his first university chair. He was a school teacher before. I believe he was paid with wheat, partly. His whole salary was not in money in Florence, but it was something with wheat. I don't know what he used to do with that wheat. I don't know, beer or, you know. Anyway, okay. So, first of all, before, you know, we should remember, talking about the othering process, that the word for 2016, according to the dictionary com, which is means how many people have been looking at that word, the highest visits was xenophobia. We need to think about that. So talking about the wider context behind us that informs all of these things that we're dealing is this word and the whole concepts behind that. And here is even more specific how, and you know, with the whole Brexit and with Trump and all of that, the idea of xenophobia and the othering have been taking higher peaks. And going back now to returning again to Hegel, of course this is philosophical language and is not easily read in the context of our modern logic, but essentially what he is saying is that the other immediately ceases to be another for me, and in my consciousness of this, I am free. What he's saying is that the moment we begin to encounter the other and understand our interrelationship with the other, the person is no longer the other, and I am free. Not them, I am free. And I would like us to really take that very seriously from a very big philosopher coming from this town when we're talking about these issues today, about othering and about the xenophobia. So, refugees. When we're thinking of refugees, we're going back to the previous slide in order to develop it and finalize that slide now. Here is again the importance of our epistemological differentiation of discourses. So the othering process is very important, and we need to differentiate what are these discourses and what is behind even all of these discourses. So we have these successive different levels of meaning, and we know, I'm not going to spend much time on that, but you know that there are very interesting systemic ideas about that. And we're talking about aid, who aids whom? If we really think about the way that I presented it so far. Yes, we're giving them some money and we're giving them counseling and all of that, but what are they giving us? What is the aid? What is the aid? When we're talking about relationality, is it us simply giving them something? What are they giving us? And we don't see it. And we don't acknowledge it. And we do not include it in the projects that we're giving them. We should. And, of course, what kind of aid? Because we may give them wheat or, or the equivalent, and they may give us, I don't know, humanity. And other sense of human sensitivity. And what kind of, you know, why do we give them any aid? And how do we give it to them? And from what perspective? And here, I want to bring a third German contribution, which I think as systemic thinkers we should take very seriously. And that is the idea of post-migration society. For those of you who don't know about it, which is really a great pity because it's an incredible movement forward. It started in Berlin as a kind of a arts event. So post-migration experience of post-migration society is mainly connected with arts and social sciences, but it's important, I think, that should come into mental health, and certainly in the context of systemic thinking, because it's such a systemic thinking. What does it mean? Doesn't mean post-after migration. No, the idea is that we are not helping them because they're different from us, but they are us. They're not different from us. Our family now includes them. And we have different peculiarities in families. And they are one of the peculiarity, and we're also peculiar in some way. So the idea of post-migration society breaks down the idea that we are helping them. It says it's us. So it's looking at the whole of all of us, and it's saying what help we need to provide for all of us, or how do we conceptualize the us. The post-migration is, in other words, the idea that don't think of simply migration, that you are here and they're there and they, you know, they're us. It's us. It's our family. It's our community. It's our society. How do we act from that epistemological background, from that epistemological premises, instead of us helping them? The us helping them has an element of othering which is unavoidable. And then, when we come to systemic research, well, then, in a sense, I've said everything, but let me spell it out. There is a plea to locate systemic research within a much wider spectrum. In other words, beyond measuring effectiveness of therapeutic methods, beyond assessing the relational impact of refugeedom, etc., not to say that these are not important things. That's why I'm saying beyond, not instead of, but expanding it. And systemic research, for me then, should be to enable us to be troubled, because usually we're avoiding being troubled, by what we discover when we subject as many relevant phenomena to judicious epistemological scrutiny. In other words, ask the questions that I've been asking so far, and many more, because this is just a very brief presentation. So, when I'm saying that, of course, we go back to Gregory Bateson, and for me, this is one of the best, really, the best quotations you can get. I'm very proud of myself that I found it. So, he says, and actually I tamed that because he has some really more horrible words to say. He says, I have very little sympathy for the arguments from the world's needs. There is a need, let's do something, there is a need. So he says, I have very little sympathy from the world's needs. I distrust the applied scientists' claim that what they do is useful and necessary. I suspect that their impatient enthusiasm for action, their raring to go, is not just a symptom of impatience, nor is it pure buccaneering ambition. I suspect that it covers deep epistemological panic. Now, this is vintage Gregory Bateson. This is vintage Gregory Bateson. So that's what I'm interested in. What is the deep epistemological panic? What is the deep epistemological panic that we're running away from, and we come to this of a simplified formula that we usually use today? So I will try to articulate perhaps a little bit better then that the systemic research for me, the aim of this is respectfully, sensitively, prudently, and humbly, but also determinedly and with unwavering focus to scrutinize the epistemological impact of the dominant narratives and of the relevant societal discourses within which we formulate our very presuppositions of what the phenomena we're dealing with are and how these formative epistemologies affect what we do. For example, just think of some of these things. The systemics of funding. What is funded and what is not funded? We know, you know, if you talk about evidence-based, if you talk about symptoms, it's funded. If you talk about needs, it's funded. If you talk about what they have to teach us, anybody got any funding for that? No. No. The projectization of assistance, there is a new field about that. Everything we do is within a project. By the time you finish the project, you have to start it. Before you blink, it's finished. The funding comes to the end. Is that a proper scientific project, a way of investigating? I don't think that Hegel would have been able to write anything if he was subjected to this type of limitations. And thinking about, you know, the implications also is the victimization of those we want to help. That's another big one. And this is just for starters. There are so many other serious systemic questions that can be asked about research. So I want to think about, you know, what I'm still going to say in the limited time that I have. I'm going to focus on the epistemological panic in relation to basically four areas: home, trauma, victim identity, and the nature of our aid, all in both their essentialist as well as constructivist nature. Refugees are real people, but also they are our own construct. Homes are real homes that are damaged, but also their own constructs. And this is the systemic epistemological dance for us that we need to become experts in. And the systemic thinking urges us, provides the potentiality for us to do in order to see them in their both natures. They are essentialist as well as constructivist. And each one of them, the way that I will briefly outline them for you now, are not as final recipes or something, but as useful, hopefully, systemic frameworks. So, in order to do that, let's start from the beginning when we're talking about the involuntary dislocation, and that is a big question why I call it this and nothing else. But when we try really to be mercilessly meticulous about these epistemological differentiations, we need to be very clear about the language that we're using. So when we're talking about involuntary dislocation, it's important that we differentiate it. In other words, crudely speaking, when we're talking about refugees, at least five moments. First is the experience of no longer feeling at home at the space that is considered home. And we forget that that ever happens, but that's the original dislocation. When a person who grew up and felt and knew the home and everything, the neighborhood, everything, the culture, the language, one day feels that actually that is no longer viable and is no longer safe. That experience, how many of us have we researched? How many of us have we? Because that actually is the one that stays and marks people for years to come, regardless of what they encounter after that. And that's the kind of mistrust of how I'm going to reconnect with another home again. This has nothing to do with trauma, please. This is something else. But it's, for me, very important and vital in discerning the different moments of this, what we call, refugee experience. And then after that, immediately the moment you feel uncomfortable in your own home, you're looking for something else. Search for another one, safer and better. And then you try to locate something in different ways, and then struggle to settle there. And finally, the most important thing is the struggle to address all of these and their relationship, all of this together. What sense does it make for a person, a human being? Please, this is not PTSD symptoms or anything like that. This is, I don't know what you want to call it. You call it disorientation, you call it distress, you call it whatever, but it's people are shaken to the core of their beings. That's not just mental health. That is not just psychiatric symptoms. That is much more. So how do you make sense of all of these things? And how do you connect them with at least three homes? The home of origin, the current home, whatever that is, and the ideal or the aspired home. So making it actually much more real, I found it useful to have what I call the home grid, which, you know, here you have the different homes, and you realize that people have predominantly positive or predominantly negative connection with that. And for me, I keep repeating, this is a framework for us to keep in mind. Because when we're talking with people, the moment they're one minute they're talking about their own home from the past, then they're talking about an aspired home, then they're talking about that, there is a confusion. It's an understandable one. It's an understandable confusion. But we need to try to address that confusion. We don't just simply go along with that. And this is just one humble attempt to differentiate between some homes. And you can use this as a framework for you when you work there, or you can use it even as a technique, instead of sitting down with them and your interactions can do this. And you can even take it further. Because therefore, what we're talking about is not just simply the reality of a home, but what I would call homeness. And again, where in Germany? And who talked about homeness? Heimat? Another big German philosopher. Who? Heidegger. Heidegger spoke about homeness, and there is a lot about homeness that today we can understand better, whatever we think of Heidegger as a person or politically or whatever, but his whole idea of Heimat, very relevant for our thinking today about refugees. So homeness is not just, we don't have just simply different multiple homes, which we do, and they're all context related, as systemic thinkers would remind us. But the gradations of the dimensions of homeness. So I call homeness as the degree of the strength of the feeling of home, of experiencing a place as home in terms of stronger or weaker, more powerful or less powerful, in terms of its centrality to our lives or not, etc. In other words, the dimension or the quality of home. So it's not that you are at home or you are not at home. You go to a restaurant and you create some sort of familiarity with the place if you go three times. So there are different types of homes and different strengths. So we could even have what I would call a cartography of homeness, representing it in terms of different shapes or different strengths or different centrality or things like that. Or if you want to do it more in terms of a technique or in terms of interaction, a cartography of homeness in terms of, you know, their main past homes, how central they were they, different textures, different feelings, etc., etc. There is a lot we can do the moment we begin to think creatively and out of the box and using our systemic arsenal of concepts and directions. So, we spoke about home, now let's talk about trauma, which, my goodness, I mean, if we can begin from that, there is no end. But anyway, trauma for me is one of the possibly most cancerous growths and tumors that has developed in our society, because it was very useful at the beginning and now it has outlived its usefulness. And it refers to, I don't know what it refers to anymore, because it refers to from the most trivial discomfort to the most severe psychiatric disorder. And we all call them indiscriminately trauma. In every discussion, if you see a lot of the debates, simply people refer to different ideas of trauma. And these are not spelled out. I mean, very briefly, and I don't want to spend too much time here, at least there are six uses of the word trauma, at least. You know, it's the colloquial one, any kind of discomfort. If you're waiting 20 minutes for a bus and it's not coming, you're traumatized. I mean, please, this is not mine. I mean, I read it in the newspaper. I mean, or the trauma that Manchester United lost or whatever. I mean, we're talking about that all the time. So then we have the original kind of psychoanalytic trauma, which is the intrapsychic developmental pathological structure. That requires psychoanalytic work to be treated. Then we have the PTSD that is dominant, but also we have the majority, the overwhelming majority, not everybody has PTSD. The overwhelming majority of people have experienced some kind of trauma, whatever that means, which is basically as a response to their exposure to adversity. And then there is specific traumas like disaster, combat, and all of that. And of course you have collective trauma, and we had a beautiful presentation yesterday and from Israel, from Michal. So the dominant epistemology of trauma is of course not systemic, and I'm really dismayed when wonderful systemic thinkers and practitioners just simply unthinkingly use a linear and non-systemic definition of trauma. And because trauma, basically, the way it is generally conceptualized is that an event causes trauma, which is the most linear, causal, reductive epistemology you can imagine. Event causes a trauma. I mean, that's not the case. Not even in psychoanalysis. Or in no way, it's just simply one event causes a trauma. There are other factors need to intervene for that trauma, however it is defined, to be developed. So the question is, how can we think about it systemically? Well, simply not every event is experienced in the same way by everyone, and there is a systemic interaction of contexts. So, the first lesson we give to beginners about systems is context and meaning. But what is context? Context, there is a complexity of contexts, and perhaps there is time for us to enter that box and start unpacking it and try to understand the interconnections and the systemic connectedness of the different contexts. So there are different variables that mediate between the devastating events and the way they're experienced by individuals. And again, thinking about that, here we have different ways of understanding this process. First, there is the exposure to the events. Then there is the experience of these events. Then there is the impact of the experience. In other words, a person is exposed to some situation, they are frightened, they cry, then we're human beings. What is the impact of the fact that I've now cried? What do I do with that? So it's not just the event, it's not just the experience, it's the impact, is the way that I process, the way I experienced it and I reacted. And all of these refer to the wider contexts that have been defining these. So, here we have a list of different factors that we know that affect the way that we experience events. from gender to age to all of these things, and there are different, and this is what I call meaning attribution processes, because these different contexts and their interplay and their interaction are the ones that create the meaning that will impose, that will attribute to an event and will form our own experience. So, and what these experiences usually are overwhelming, and when they're overwhelming experiences, what usually happens is a lack of complexity and oversimplification, a polarization, and there are all sorts of different polarizations, as healthy them traumatized, as local them other, bad immigrants, good refugees, refugees are welcome here, refugees are out, resilient refugees, traumatized refugees. We can do everything or we can do nothing, we're impotent or we're omnipotent, etc. And what usually happens for me, the main, rhetorically I always say that the main casualty of adversity is complexity. In other words, under the emotional and other resulting pressures, plus the dominant societal discourses, there is a tendency to abandon complexity, to oversimplify, to polarize at all levels. And there is no space to think, no space to act, and there is a kind of, we know about the impulsive action. But what I would like us to think is that also there is also impulsive conceptualization. And it's what I would call epistemological acting out. And this is what our friend Bateson was talking about. So we need to be aware of our epistemological acting out. And this is what leads to pathologization of human suffering through pathological and pathologizing epistemologies. So, of course, we need to make a difference between distress and disorder in these situations. And in order to restore complexity, I have introduced this many years ago and has been used widely since, the adversity grid that helps us to realize that people, not only individuals, families, communities, and societies, react inevitably negatively. There is some negative results, but also there are some positive results, and this is what I call adversity-activated development, which means that as all cultures and in all languages, we have the idea that whatever doesn't kill you strengthens you, and that is a fact. People who have gone through these situations do experience some life-changing meaning that can give them more strength. And of course, there are a lot of unchanged things, some negative unchanged and some positive unchanged. And the positive unchanged is what I call resilience. Now, we don't have much time to go into the different definitions of resilience, which is another big problem, because in the same way as trauma is badly defined, resilience is equally badly defined. And if we don't do that, we cannot make a distinction between being victims of circumstances and developing a victim identity. And this is really very, very important. And that leads us to the final slide, which we need to make a difference between what I call technological interventions and synergic interventions. Within the technological interventions, we go and fix their problems. Within the synergic interventions, which I hope increasingly systemic thinkers will be engaged in, what we try to do is try to identify their existing strengths as well as their newly acquired strengths from their own exposure to adversity, and collaborate with them, work synergically with them. We're not there to fix them. And please, let's be very careful about that. Because if we're trying to fix them, certainly you can, and we should in some ways. But if we don't put it within a systemic umbrella, we are committing not just simply epistemological errors, but also very serious ethical issues. So this is what I wanted to say. And thank you very much for listening to me.
want to thank you very much for this lecture, especially because it's nice to have Hegel coming to Heidelberg through a Cypriot, South African, Yugoslavian, British psychotherapist. That's wonderful. Thank you very much, Rino. So we are in the middle of the conference, you know. And before you go, I would ask Matthias to and some other.